Like, comment, share, and subscribe. Hit that notification bell in the upper right-hand corner. Follow me on all forms of social media. Check me out at thedrummerguy.com. And enjoy the following presentation.
Hey, this is Dan.
Hi, how's it going?
Peachy keen, sir. How yourself?
I'm doing great. Thank you so very much for taking the time to do this interview.
My pleasure.
Oh, awesome. Well, it's great to be able to talk to you, and it's great to be able to talk about an album that I never would have thought was going to happen, but I'm so very thankful that you guys were able to make this album, The God-Shaped Void, coming out on Valentine's Day, of all days, on Inside Out Music.
Yeah, a lot of people never thought this album would happen. We weren't so sure ourselves, but, you know, the God smiled on us and gave us the opportunity to make it so.
And I'm so thankful for that, too, because from beginning to end, this is what I was so hoping to hear when a new album was announced. I mean, this covered all the ground that I wanted to hear, both new and old, and it just sounds like a fantastic Psychotic Waltz album.
Yeah. Have you got a chance to hear any of it yet?
Oh, yeah. From start to finish. I absolutely love this thing.
Oh, okay, so you had a pre-press release.
I did.
Okay, some people are jealous.
Yeah, I'm very fortunate to have been able to check it out. It was one of the first promos I was able to get this year, so I've been pretty much rocking it since the beginning of the year. And yeah, just like I was saying, it covers so much ground of what I was hoping for this album, both new and old. And again, it's so great to be able to hear this rejuvenation of the band in 2020.
Well, thank you, man. We appreciate it. We're definitely, I mean, obviously that's what we want to hear from people is that they enjoy it. You know, of course, we're ready to accept that there's people that don't, but it is what it is. We took our best shot, and it took a long time. You know, we started working on that thing back in 2012 after we did our first couple of reunion tours. And you know, we're a lot slower getting together. We don't have the time that we did back when we were young and single and all living in the same town and practicing five nights a week. So it was a bit of a process, but we wanted to make sure that we were happy with it. You know, if there was anything, I mean, literally, we could say there's a couple of parts here and there that, you know, I'd say, well, that's not my favorite part, but everybody else was happy with it, so cool, we'll let it go. But there was nothing where, like, all five of us were like, oh, that part's not good, man, we should do something else. Like, there's nothing that we let slide, you know? We always went back to the drawing board and reworked parts until we were happy with them, and, you know, we'd listen back to them and go, yeah, that passes the thumbs-up test. So there you go.
Yeah, again, you know, it's just, it's great to see that. I mean, especially, like you said, too, like, you know, moving away from each other, being able to start lives outside of Psychotic Waltz, family, kids, all these things that can happen in someone's life. And, you know, being able to have that on the side and not losing that musical chemistry. I mean, the more I hear it, it's just, you know, it's just like, it feels like such a great Psychotic Waltz album because it does feel so natural.
Yeah, somebody, I can't quote you who, but threw out there that it almost seems like we picked up where we left off in 1996 with Bleeding, but added a little bit of modern, you know, technology and flair to it. And I think that's pretty accurate. You know, we didn't go out of our way to, you know, sound hip or modern or anything. In fact, if anything, we wanted a more organic sound because, quite honestly, that's what we were used to. That's what we grew up on. That's, you know, our favorite albums are, you know, the old, you know, classic metal albums, the Black Sabbaths and stuff of the day, the Pink Floyds and, you know, even AC/DC and Kiss and just, you know, pure rock and roll, pure heavy metal is what we grew up on. And, you know, we try to give that back to another generation and hope that they pick up on it, enjoy it. There was one of the songs that we have on there actually came about from going through when we first started getting together. We're like, well, where do we start? What's going to be the first song we work on? And it was actually a song that we had worked on before we broke up back in 1997. It's it probably would have been the next Psychotic Waltz song. Called The Fallen now, but I don't know what it would have sounded like if we finished it back in 96. I'm sure it wouldn't have been quite as good as it came out now. We've all kind of grown a little musically, so we were able to, you know, add some, you know, musical magic to it, so to speak. But yeah, that song in particular, that's the only one that was a leftover remnant from there. So that was, is that is kind of our jumping off starting point, so to speak. it was all kind of add-ons. You know, we had a little riff here and a little riff saved up there, and getting together in the jam room and just playing what felt right. And it just, it mixed. That's the thing about me and Brian, the other guitar player, is we've always just had a good chemistry. We can get together in a room for 10 minutes and make something up, where I feel blessed to have that with him, because I've never had that with anybody else. You know, there were other guitar players that I've known and jammed with in my life, and there was just never a spark of creativity the way me and Brian have. So it definitely helped. Definitely helped.
Oh, I can absolutely imagine. And, you know, it's great to know that song that was a remnant from the past, The Fallen, is like a smack dab right in the middle of the album, because, you know, everything that comes before and after it just, it does feel so natural for the album that I wouldn't have even guessed that The Fallen was anything could have been consumed previously, because it feels so good together.
You're probably one of only 6 or 7 people that know that until now. But it's true. It's very true.
In fact,
just to date myself even more, the version that I busted out of my archives was on a 4-track cassette tape. We used to use our Tascam Porta 1 cassette recorder to do all our demos in the jam room. And we'd have we'd have about two mics on the drums, just, you know, on the side of his kit, and we'd have 2 other mics on the side of the room, kind of one in front of Brian's guitar cabinet and one in front of mine, and then the bass would, you know, bleed through in the middle. And I came across that, and I was like, oh, this sounds, you know, promising. I showed it to, I had to, you know, import it into my computer, hooked my RCA cables actually to an audio jack, and made an MP3 out of it. And then I was able to email it to the guys and go, hey, what if we start with this? And everybody was like, yeah, where'd you get that? Like, well, long story, but yeah, I had a lot of old cassette tapes.
And what is that like for you? Like, when you go back and you listen to those old demos on the 4-track Tascam, as compared to like listening to this brand new album?
Well, you know, it does show a level of immaturity that we had at the time, songwriting-wise, and technology-wise even. But, you know, it wasn't that immature at the time. You know, for us, that's just where we were in that space and time. Just for those that might not know, we broke up after our fourth album came out in 96. We did a couple tours into 97 and then broke up, went our separate ways, you know, musical differences, personal differences, all that stuff. But when we got together back in 2011, all original members, everybody got along great, you know, a lot of water under the bridge, people have grown and moved on, and we're still together since 2011. But that tour that we did, it was for the Power of Metal tour with Nevermore and Symphony X. And they were, those guys in that band, they were happy to have us there. But when I busted out some of the gear that we had, for example, like for the synthesizer stuff and the samples, I actually had the same gear that I had back in 1996. I packed it up, put it on the shelf, and didn't touch it. You know, dusted off the cobwebs. I mean, we're talking about SCSI drives, zip disks, 100 megabyte zip disks, if you're old enough to remember that.
Oh, yes.
You know, it's pretty ancient technology to be putting on the road. In the, you know, in the 2011s, they're like, what is this? How does this work? It was, to them, it was very alien. But to me, I was like, this is what it is. You know, we've upgraded since then. We decided, okay, let's get a laptop and kind of, you know, size everything down a little bit easier to, you know, manage. But yeah, it was funny. It was like a bit of a time warp for them, I guess.
Yeah, and I remember that tour getting announced, and I was so jealous that I didn't live over in Europe to be able to see that tour, because that's a perfect build to me from start to finish. You know, it's just like 3 very different bands being able to tour together, but all making sense together to be able to tour. You know, whether it was a long-standing band like Psychotic Waltz getting back together, a long-standing band like Nevermore, or one that was in between like Symphony X.
Yeah, that was it was a very good time, man. We all had a great time on that tour. We appreciated the fact that they, you know, chose us to, you know, be part of it. And man, I tell you, it was so professionally handled. You know, it made us long for, why couldn't it have been like that back in the 90s when we were touring? I mean, they had everything covered. They had roadies for everything, sound men for everything. It was just such a well-oiled machine. You know, it just made us kind of jealous that we saw how it could be done and how it was being done. But back in the 90s, we never had it that good. It was a rough road for us back in the day. But that is what it is.
Yeah, and you know, and speaking of that, you know, like obviously with everything off the stage being able to be handled so well with roadies and being treated so well on that tour, I mean, what was it like for you to be able to, for that first show, being able to get back on stage at Psychotic Waltz and be able to like go right into the first song and see that crowd reaction?
That was awesome. And as a side note, that was actually my birthday for our first show there. So to me, I was, you know, had a little extra feather in my cap, like, this is the coolest birthday present I think I've ever had. Seeing old, I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with our crowd over in Europe, or European crowds in general tend to be pretty faithful to bands that they really like. And we would, back in the 90s, we would see a lot of the same faces year after year. You know, some people would go gig after gig, you know, and follow us around for a week in their car, following the bus, literally sleeping on the side of the road and stuff. And we saw a lot of those same people from the 90s show up in 2011. And it was great, man. I felt, it was like, hey, you know, I don't remember your name, but I remember you. You know, I'm good with faces and terrible with names. but we saw a lot of the same people, and the looks on their faces of like, oh my God, I can't believe, you know, I'm here, you're here, you're doing this, this is great. And it felt really great to be part of that. And again, we all felt really blessed and fortunate to have that chance. You know, a lot of bands don't have the chance to begin with to go over to Europe and play, and even fewer have the chance to be broken up for 14 odd years and go back and do it again. So it's definitely not something that we take for granted. But yeah, that first show, it was really cool. I don't know. I can't say too much. There was a little bit of a gloom in the backstage area because Nevermore were, I mean, it's pretty well documented now, they were kind of not getting along at that point and breaking up, in the process of breaking up. So it was kind of sad to see that happen. At the same time, me and the other guys were really happy to play with them. You know, Jeff Loomis, amazing guitar player. He even told me one night in a kind of emotional chat we had, he's like, dude, I can't believe that I'm sitting here and we're on a bus touring together. I just never thought this would happen. And I was like, dude, you and me both, brother. So yeah, it was a good feeling, man. It was a good night, and it led to many more. You know, a lot of people thought that was just a one and done type of reunion tour, and we, you know, fade away. But we went back the next year, 2012. We played in Greece for the first time. We did the Prog Power in Atlanta last year. We did quite a few shows, little festivals and stuff over in Europe. I don't want to bore your American listeners with, but yeah, we've, you know, constantly been busy and working on the album in between. The plan now basically is learn all the songs that we just recorded for the album and learn how to play them live, because some of those go back a couple of years and we haven't played them in a while. So we're planning on going back to Europe in October, maybe a week or 2 weeks worth of shows. And then we'll see what happens after that. You know, we are kind of talking about the next move. Do we do another album? Was this a one-off? And we're all kind of with the same mind that we're going to write and see how it feels. And if it still has that, you know, the chemistry that you mentioned, then we'll go from there.
Oh, and I'm just so glad to be able to hear that, too. You know, being able to play those shows over in Europe, being able to play Prog Power as well. I've been fortunate enough to be able to go there a couple years. I wasn't able to go last year, but hearing that you guys were going to be playing that was the most devastated I was not being able to make it to that show because you guys were playing. But I had to imagine that had to be a great feeling, being able to see all of these fans of Psychotic Waltz, being able to see you in America and playing another show.
That was very surreal. Okay, so we started, we get in, we're doing our load-in thing, and we're probably thinking, you know, we're the low guys on the totem pole here. We've never played in America outside of San Diego. We did a show in Las Vegas back in the 80s. We did a show with Dream Theater, a couple shows with Dream Theater like in Arizona, and we used to play in TJ, and that was it, our little southwestern corner of the States. We never broke out of here. Our music just didn't take off. It was too, you know, back in the 80s, it was all hair metal, and then it went into grunge, and we just really missed our, you know, dark metal calling, I guess, for the States. But turns out I was wrong about that, because when we start loading in, there's guys over there that were on the crew asking for autographs and going into like detail about some of our albums, and not just our albums. Like, you know, I got a side project thing called Dark Star that I did that I don't think anybody knows about it here. And the guy's telling me, yeah, I got that CD, it blew me away that they were that into it and they knew details, you know, down to stuff like that. And the I'm drawing a blank on the promoter's name right now, but he looked at me with a grin. He's all, "Oh yeah, we know who you are." And I was like, "Wow." Made me feel loved. Had a shot with them, and you know, again, felt very, very fortunate that they tapped us to come out there and play it. And I heard there was a, you know, how they announced the bands for next year at the show, who's going to be playing next year. That the previous year when they announced us, that he said, "Man, it was like a standing ovation type of applause." I didn't see it. I wasn't there for it, but that's what he told me. And again, just one of those things that, wow, it makes you feel really good. You know, the people there here in the States knew about us, loved us, and, you know, gave us that kind of a reaction.
And that is just amazing to hear that on all fronts. And yeah, just thinking about that with Prog Power as well, the fact that there was a standing ovation for that, and even though it's a bit of a smaller audience here in America when it comes to progressive music, I mean, the fact that there is that diehard fans that are over here, and then when you are able to tour over in Europe, you are able to get even more of those diehard fans and be able to, yeah, like, to show off the new music that's going to be happening. And, you know, it's just, that is just so cool to be able to see after all this time that, you know, this music really does matter to more than just the band, more than someone like me, but worldwide, people are able to grab onto something with Psychotic Waltz and just be able to really enjoy what you guys produce.
Yeah, and it makes us feel pretty glad, you know, pretty happy about it, and proud to be part of it. We're all really proud to be part of it, and you know, we do take pride in our music. Me and Brian, the other guitar player, we always used to say when we were young, we're out to achieve goosebumps. You know, when we listen back to it, we like to get goosebumps, go, "Ooh, that part was cool." And when we hear it from other people, in Germany in particular, they call it the chicken skin. "Ooh, I got the chicken skin." We're like, "Yes, mission accomplished."
Oh, that is so cool. And, you know, and speaking of that as well, you know, obviously with such a long time, 96 being the last recorded material up until mm-hmm. now, I mean, what was it like to be able to decide, like, what single was going to be released off an album that has been so long awaited?
You know, it wasn't that difficult. We've had much lengthier arguments about smaller things than that. Everybody does want their part, and everybody, you know, we all got the same goal. We all want it to be perfect. You know, we always used to say, "Man, we should get together and make our masterpiece, you know, swan song, Abbey Road type of album." And so everybody wants it to be the best. You know, the challenging part is everybody has a slightly different opinion of what the best is. So there will be a little friction here and there. And we just kind of came to the simple rule of, hey, man, you know, no egos, no bruised feelings, majority rules. You know, if 3 out of the 5 guys like this, let's go with that, because 3 guys are probably more likely right than 1 or 2 guys. Made sense. We all said, yeah. So with the single dropping for Devils and Angels being the first lyric video released, basically, we all just sent our manager, Eula Garrett, by the way, shout out to him. Very glad to have him. He's been inspirational and so helpful in the whole transition of us getting back together and touring and helping with the album and all the professional stuff that we're too dumb and don't have time to do. He's helped us out, and he threw this up at us. What song do you guys want to be coming out as the single or as the video? And we all basically just threw 3 or 4 songs out there. And the common consensus was, yeah, Devils and Angels wound up being there. There's another one going to drop probably on Friday, I think, for All the Bad Men, which I probably shouldn't say, but too late, I just did. So there you go. That's how that happened. It was just, you know, we all had common ground. You know, we might have picked a couple that the other guys didn't, but the common ground was what it was, and we went with that. Pretty easy.
On the one part, don't worry, I will be actually releasing this on Friday, so I think that'll actually be a good timing to be able to do that as well, so no worries there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so, you know, with that, I mean, it's just, it's great to see, you know, like, when it comes to things like that, and getting that together, and working on the album, just like you said, no bruised egos, doing things for the betterment of the band, majority mm-hmm. rules, things like that. I mean, yeah, I mean, there's so many bands that have fallen to that in the past, and, you know, with a Psychotic Waltz breaking up for different reasons, you know, it's like, I'm glad that you guys were able to come back together and drop all those preconceived notions and just try to do what's best for the band in 2020.
Yeah, I'm glad we did too. Yeah, we all had a few really down-to-earth, heart-to-heart chats, because, you know, there was there's a lot of water under the bridge, but you know, we're different people now. And, you know, we have the opportunity to do something pretty special that not a lot of folks get to do. And we want to make the most of it and have the best time doing it. So a lot of the times, you know, maybe advice to anybody else out there struggling, you know, whether it's a relationship or a band that's bad vibes, is communication really is key. You hear it, it sounds cliche, but you know, once things got out in the open and, you know, cleared the air, it's a lot easier to go, oh, all right, well, you know, whatever the situation may be, and move from there. But at least you got a starting point rather than just, you know, overall bad vibes of whatever the case may be. So,
oh, couldn't agree more.
That's my psychological point for the moment.
Oh, so fully agreed. And, you know, switching it up a little bit on that, another thing that I love so much about this album is not just the audio, but the visual aspect of it as well. I think the album cover is just absolutely stellar. I love the colors that's being in there. All these different tones that you don't normally see on an album cover that just flow together so well, and seeing the planets in the background and stuff. Like, how did it come together using this as the artwork?
That's our man, Travis Smith. We've known Travis. Some of the guys went to high school with him, and he's been around since our original artist, Mike Cliff, ducked out on the after Mosquito, the third album. Travis did Bleeding, and he did my Dark Star thing, and his career really took off, and he does everybody's album. You know, you can't swing a dead cat without seeing one of his album cover somewhere. And I'm proud of him. You know, we still talk, and you know, he was the obvious choice to go for it. I think he would have been pissed at us if we didn't ask him to do it, but of course we would. So we gave him demos of the songs and said, hey, you know, whatever you see, draw it. You know, whatever you hear and it gives you imagery, draw it. And then, you know, that's what he came up with. The original one was a little bit dark. We all kind of, well, a couple of us were like, maybe add a little bit more color. It's kind of dark. We don't want it to be a unprintable, you know, black gooey mess on the CD covers or on the T-shirts. And, you know, he revised it a little bit, kind of like what we do with the songs, you know, back to the drawing board, a little tweak here, a little tweak there, added this, added that. But yeah, those are all just straight out of his head. There's very little that any of us had any input on that, other than, you know, maybe do this logo, you know, put a candle here, you know, move it up to the corner, you know, do stacked one versus horizontal one, or try this or that. But yeah, he's got his gift for imagery, and you know, we're lucky he's part of the team.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And he's always been one of my favorite artists when it comes to album artwork. He's always done some of my favorite album covers of all time. And this is slowly but surely becoming one of my favorite album artworks as well, too. And it's great to see that Travis was able to get such inspiration from the album. And yeah, like, the more that I look at the album cover, the more that I can see where he was coming from on everything. And I'm able to see all these great little details that's going on there. And when you match it up with the music, it feels so cool to see that.
Yeah, which is something that a lot of people miss listening to just iTunes. They might only see the cover. You know, that's the thing that infuriated me with iTunes right off the get-go back in the day until now, is you just don't get the album work, the artwork, the back cover, the inside pages, you know, the little fold-out posters. All that's gone these days, you know, because it's such a, I don't know, just the way that it's, I mean, I get it. Maybe it's hard to do that, but just the way that it's delivered to people is such not a actual visual art friendly medium, I guess. So that's why a lot of people buy the albums. You know, they got the big 12-inch vinyls, you know, where you could really see it a lot better. And those are still cool. I got albums hanging up on my wall still because I like looking at them.
Yeah, I love that. I love being able to hang up vinyl of albums that I care so much about and just really love the artwork of, and just being able to hang that up and just look at that detail, look at the memories that those albums give me, and just being able to smile as I go past them.
Yeah, I agree. 100%.
Awesome. You know, it's great to see everything that's going on in the world of Psychotic Waltz right now. Being able to go back to Europe and playing shows again. A brand new amazing album coming out on Valentine's Day for Inside Out Music, and everything that'll be going on in the future as well. And, you know, just with that, I thank you so much for being able to take this time to be able to talk to me about everything. I've been able to learn so much about what was going on, being able to hear some amazing stories on your end. And again, I can't thank you enough for taking the time to be able to talk to me about all of it.
Well, actually, it's my pleasure. you know how disappointed we would have been if we did all this, and you know, the old saying, build it and they'll come. Imagine if we went through all this, made our album, and nobody cared. That would be a disappointment. So I thank you for the time. My pleasure. It's great to hear back from not just to do an interview, but from actually somebody that really knows the band. I don't want to drop any names, but the last interview I did, I got the feeling they weren't very closely associated with it. They kept calling the band Psycho Waltz. And I was like, okay. I don't think he's a close follower. I'll let it slide. But yeah, so thanks, man. I really do appreciate it.